Good morning. My name is Rita Loki, and I'm pleased to introduce you to our speaker today, which is Gwen Eishen. Gwen was raised in Duncanville in South Dallas, and she's about to complete her master's in urban wildlife. She has lots of hobbies. She's an ambitious gardener, an animal rescuer, a hiker, and a fellow master naturalist. And today she's going to talk about one of her favorite subjects, and that is animal scat. So I'll turn it over to Gwen.
All right. So yeah, so I'm a DFW native, grew up in South Dallas. Duncanville is where I went to high school. But I've hiked the Trinity my whole life. I used to go to what was the Dallas Nature Center. Now it's Cedar Ridge Preserve, but it's the same plot of land. So that's what I grew up exploring. All right, so who's Scat That? This is one of my favorite topics. I love it when people ask me to talk about this, and I love to be the person who talks about it. I don't know. It's just a fun topic, you know, and it's a big part of wildlife, of recognizing what's in that habitat, what's around, is paying attention to those signs. A lot of kids, that's what I do. I've taught kids outdoors for about a decade now, and, you know, they might never see a creature besides a roly-poly and a butterfly, and so they don't think there's wildlife out there. So showing these signs to them is very important, so they recognize that wildlife is there year round, whether we see them or not. All right. So first of all, this is a horrible distorted image, but a satellite image of DFW. If y'all didn't know, we do have a great urban wildlife community here. The Trinity River is this huge corridor linking, even though we have this huge metropolis, the animals are using it, you know, as a greenway for them to travel and explore. So there is plenty of wildlife here. I don't know how many of y'all are on Reddit, but a lot of people all the time are like, where do you go outside? Where do you hike? You know, they want Colorado, they want Montana, but y'all all know there's plenty of wildlife here. There's plenty of beautiful spots, green spaces, places to just walk with your family. And so getting people more and more comfortable is important. Awesome. Okay. So this GIF is one I found online. This is actually from Central Park, New York City. And it's a cute little group of coyotes playing with the trash bag. So even in the big metropolis cities, like, there's wildlife. This is a, you know, a predator family. There are studies in Chicago, in LA, of bobcats, coyotes living just right among the neighborhoods with people. So there's plenty of resources for them, of course. So recognizing those signs is important. All right. So, if, you know, this is just tips and tricks when you're out there. You want to start observing any unique habitats or unique habitat features when you're walking around. So I'm paying attention to that day on that visit. What's the temperature out? What's the terrain like? You know, where's the water sources? Because those animals are going to visit it there. Their tracks or scat would look different based off those things. If there's public access, because, you know, a lot of the time it's just dog poop. People don't always pick it up, you know. So explaining that to people. And knowing, you know, how close you are to a human neighborhood, what native species would actually be comfortable going around that area. And so when you do actually find the scat, look around, consider what resources are around and the pressures to obtain them. Because if they are, you know, releasing their bowels there, they feel safe in that moment. It's a vulnerable thing. Like, even us in a public restroom, we close that stall and we lock it. You know, we don't want anyone sneaking up on us. It's an intimate moment. So if they do release it, you know, I want to know why. Why this spot right here? Why do they feel safe in this location? Are they in a group? Are they by themselves? What kind of individual was this? All right. And so then scat. We know it means food remains, but then there's tons of great words for it. And when I'm teaching kids, you know, I'll let them name as many as they can. They can say the bad words for this lesson if they want to. But we get dung, scat, spore, dropping, stool, crap, dump, load, turd, excrement. I know I love these words. And then you can get a little bit more specific with it. Fecal pellets, meadow muffins. Don't know what a meadow muffin is. So that's a fresh cow dropping. It looks like a nice baked muffin, but if you step on it, like, you're gonna slip. few mitts. It's like when hunters find a fresh, you know, pile right there. So they're on the trail of whatever they're looking after. Spraint. Spraint is for otters. It's probably one of the stinkiest things I've ever smelt. In a previous job, I worked at the Dallas Zoo taking care of the otters, and they eat, you know, mackerel and crayfish, and it's awful. It's the worst thing. Like, they're the cutest things in the world, but the smell is probably the worst in all the zoo animals. And it's a closed and confined space. They have a heated floor, so that adds to that smell. Guano. Guano is going to be our bats, but also our birds. Some of the birds are considered guano. Frass is insects. Castings are the earthworms. Coprolites. Y'all know what a coprolite is? So dinosaurs. Fossilized poop. Yeah, so I have my own collection of coprolites. It's like my family, when we go to museums, I have to check like gift shops on road trips. I have to check the like rock people on the side of the road in the ditch. I'm like, do you have coprolites? It's a big deal. It's very exciting. If you want to go to the Perot, actually, if you go to Fair Park or their old storage unit, they have like lots of caprolites and also what's called urolites. So the urine puddles that have been fossilized, and measuring all that, you can get the radius. You can learn how tall that animal is, you know, do your trigonometry, you know, triangle measurements. So there's a lot of fun to it, I will say. Middens and latrines are big piles, though. Like, middens are like, you know, pack rats when they're, you find those in your garage, you find those in storage units. And then latrines, you know, we actually make latrines too, where we go together as a family, more than one bathroom stall next to each other. There's a lot of animals that use those, and I'll talk about them. Oh. All right, so then what is the scat saying? What is it telling us? So once you get a good picture of the scat, you know who's present in the habitat, what their current diet is, the population dynamics by total of individuals even, and then the community. Is there predator prey going on? Once you get really good at it, you can tell if it was a family unit, was it mom and some babies, was it multiple adults, you know, is it an all-male group, all-female group that's walking by? And so that's really important if you're monitoring these populations. You know, you could go out there and try to trap everybody, put a GPS collar on them. That's expensive, doesn't last long. I've done trail cameras, and that's a lot of fun too, to keep track of them, but you're only seeing them in that moment walking by the camera. So keeping track of scat is just another method to understand those populations. All right, so an animal latrine is a dung hill. You'll see these piles in the woods. I'm weird, I get excited. My family hates hiking with me because I take a picture of everything. So some animals, they're highly specific to where they relieve themselves. They have these various stereotyped routines, even we do. Most of y'all, you know, in the morning, you have 7:15 is your bathroom time, or 4:37 when you get home from traffic or something, like your family knows the bathroom's yours. Leave you alone, don't talk to you, don't pass notes under the door, you know. And animals are the same way, and some of them choose these specific locations. So raccoons are the most common. They're in these big groups, you know, a family that poops together stays together. It's a very real saying. Elephants do it, horses, antelope, deer, rabbits, skink, lizards, rodents, and even us humans. And not here in Texas specifically, but like in Africa, a lot of those plains animals, the piles of scat are telling stories for each other. They're letting them know the health of each other, where they're going, where they came from. You know, there's a lot of hidden messages that, you know, we're not smelling each other's piles. We're not paying attention to each other's diets in that way. It would be very nice, but no, we're not going to do that. But here's this picture. This is a huge pile at Cooper Lake State Park. So all these pictures are mine too. I tried to label where I saw them. But this was a huge latrine just piled over this huge log, some spilling over on the edge. And so this communal defecation station that I call it, this is a raccoon pile. So I could just imagine them at night. If you've ever, you know, gone camping, you can recognize, like, once the sun goes down, they go searching for that food. You'll hear them chitter chatter at each other, checking out each campsite, saying, yeah, there's food. No, there's not. And then once they're done eating, you know, they're going to have to relieve themselves. And then, of course, since I'm a dinosaur nerd, there are ancient latrines out there. So I'll try to say it. Dinodontosaurus, an 8-foot-long mega herbivore, similar to modern rhinos. So this is in Argentina, but this is this huge spot. So 94 poo piles per square meter, and the excrement was spread across 900 square meters. So that was a huge herd. And they all went to the restroom that day, thankfully. And, you know, it got trapped from whatever went on with the climate after that. And so I bet the scientists, when they discovered it, I bet they were giddy. Like, that's exciting. I'm not sure where all of these are now. But it's cool to realize that. And even with humans, they could scout the Lewis and Clark expedition based off their latrine, because they were eating so, like, they were shooting and killing and eating what they found, of course, while they're traveling through the woods. That's going to be a lot of digestive issues when you're eating raw meat that you're not used to. And so they were taking these mercury pills to help with the diarrhea. So the people that were excavating it, the archaeologists were able to find these latrines with high amounts of mercury that signified the Lewis and Clark group, because this was a big group of people traveling the specific route. So it's kind of cool just to study that, how, you know, deep it really goes. All right. So when you do want to get to the identification stage, though, so look at size and shape, the content of the material, you know, pay attention, learn the differences between fur, bone, seashells, animal shells, seeds, stems, and then the placement is important for me. So, like, how open was it? Were they confident when they let it go? Were they trying to hide it from somebody? And then what's called their vigilance. So vigilance, think about like vigilantes, you know, protecting you from danger. So when animals are going to the restroom, their vigilance level goes up or down of how confident they feel to be very vulnerable in that moment. They have to go to the restroom, but it's the easiest way to get eaten is when, you know, you're very vulnerable in that moment. And if y'all have dogs or cats, if you've walked them outside, they're making eye contact with you when they go to the restroom. Like, it's your job to protect them in that 10-second window. Anything could happen. It's kind of residual. I don't know if campers here, if hikers, if y'all are out in the woods and pull your pants down and you hear a noise, you know, you're going to go much faster after that. It happens. There's things out there. All right. So when you are, it's important to have a good unit of measurement. So these pens are a thing I use all the time. They have rulers on them, so it's very convenient. I also use my shoe. I know how big my shoe is, but if I sent that to somebody, you know, I'd be like, I'm a size 8. They don't know what that means or how wide it is, things like that. So in my head, keeping pictures like this is good for me, but if I want to share it with a larger community, have a simple unit of measurement. You could do a quarter, you could do a key. With kids even, I'll talk about M&M sizes that they know in their heads, you know, so it's kind of universal. You can use your hand as well, but if you don't want to go near this, you don't have to use your hand. All right, so check the content material. Pay attention if there's fur, bones, whatever. So this is gross, right? This is horrible. This is not a typical pile. So my friend sent this to me because she couldn't figure out what it was. The laser won't work on here. So first there's a black residue puddle around it. So when this was dropped, it was wet, it was gooey. That liquid has, you know, evaporated a bit, but it did leave a stain. And then we see tons of seeds in there. Do y'all know what those seeds are? Not acorns, they're smaller than that. So these are persimmon, that's right. Actually, it might be honey locust because they're a little bit rounder. Persimmons are a little bit flatter. But this animal, what happened was they ate something, all that blackness. It was organ and tissue, but it also was a lot of oil in their body. And so they started eating those seeds to kind of make up for that. It's kind of like if you ate a whole pound of bacon and you hear those gurgles. And you're just like, okay, I have to go to work today. What am I supposed to do here? You know, so you're going to eat bread. You're going to eat crackers, muffins, try to soak it up, not make it as horrible as it's about to be. So what's the most oily meal out there? Skunk. That's right. So this is when a predator eats a skunk. Usually it's like first-year-old coyotes that have left mom and they're hunting on their own. Whether it was a skunk that got, you know, died of natural causes, got hit by a car. If they eat that oil pack in that body, you know, it's going to react to them. but you know, coyotes are investigative. They're going to want to see what's a good meal. And so you'll find these piles. And then you won't see one again for years, you know, because they learned their lesson. All right. So then just telling the difference between animal-based diet, plant-based diet. So you're looking at what didn't actually digest. And so if it's meat and organs that didn't digest, it's going to be tubular shaped, less twisting, smooth. And there might be some blunt ends. If it's majority hair and bone left over, then it is twisted and tapered. It'll be a little more dry. And then the more plant-based diets will be pellet formed. When you get to the omnivores, though, it's going to get harder to, you know, have a distinct shape difference. And it depends on what they ate that day, too, or that meal. And then open placement, or check where it is to see if it's open placement. So this is a golf course. And so the course is on this side, and there's a trail with it. This is up in the colony on the side of Lake Louisville. But so this individual just went in the middle of nowhere. So this is confidence right there. They weren't scared about anybody seeing them. They were by themselves. So this is a coyote, you know, they're pretty confident when they go to the restroom. A rabbit is not going to do this. You know, a squirrel is not going to do this. So recognizing those differences and, you know, why you're paying attention to these animals' scat piles. This is awful. This is a poor little, this is a hog. So this is summertime. So this is actually at Liz Dola. This is the creek that comes from the spillway down to the property. And so I love to walk it because that's where the animals have to get their drinking water. So finding a water source is always a great spot to look for scat. But poor guy, he had a plug. And then once the plug got out, this, you know, looks like cookie dough. That's not. Oatmeal. Well, we had to know what he ate, you know, what was that hog spending all his time munching on down there? So different plants, grasshoppers in the summer are always a common thing because when you're walking through those grasses, you get 20 grasshoppers jumping in front of you. So for all these animals, that's a really easy meal to get protein in the summer when you can't, you know, catch a bird, catch a fish, a squirrel, something like that. So you're going to find a lot of scat piles. But it doesn't, you know, go through the system that smoothly. So he struggled that day for sure. So I felt for him. But here's a track of it. It's hard to tell, but this is our hog. All right. So to identify their level of vigilance, so the act of keeping careful watch, you just have to remember while they're releasing their bowels, you know, it's time away from safety and shelter. They have to go to the bathroom though. And you're not going to poop where you eat. Most of these animals will not. So it's away from home. They traveled. This is the same hog. He walked through the mud to make a little mud wallow in like 6 inches of water. So he made it a little deeper for himself. He needs to survive. It's a hot summer here in Texas. But yeah, so when I'm looking for vigilance, I'm going to examine my surroundings, where they dropped it. You know, where those predators would have come from, were they hidden from a ridge, things like that. So I'm trying to put myself in the place of that animal in that moment. How confident were they when they went, you know, to try to help me figure out who it was. But yeah, here's some more grasshoppers, more honey locust seeds coming out here, really dry summer poops. I know. So this is kind of just a lesson in how bird feeders are great for the birders. But then when the mammals and the other animals start realizing there's food, their vigilance level goes really low. They're very confident, I'm fine to waste time here. And he's lucky the hawk missed, but it still takes him a minute to realize, oh, that's my worst enemy, you know? But like, I don't know if this is cracked corn or millet or whatever it is. And then what's funny is all the little magpies, they know what's happening. They're not warning the squirrel either, you know? So I'm sure they want to watch it. This is entertainment for them. But the squirrel got away for this. But his vigilance almost ruined his life. All right, so just helping to identify some more scat. So this is a bandana you can get. You can buy it online. It's specimens are shown twice the actual size. So, but it's really easy to, you know, have that on your head, take it off when you see something, measure it. I have this in my back pocket. There's also a keychain collection from the Northwood Guides Incorporated. They're a really good resource, but this one has all the different animals and their descriptions and pictures on it with a ruler. So you can easily put this on like a little zip keychain and use it while you're out there if you don't want to use your phone or you don't have a book with you. But it's an easy guide if you don't want to use the bandana. It's a great gift, by the way. All right, so the most common ones. So deer and rabbit. So they look pretty identical. If you really want to get down to like the circumference of a deer's butthole to a rabbit's, but you can go there. There are measurement scales. When I was in college, I went to A&M. I took a livestock breeding class, but you learned about even for cows, they're using the circumference of that butthole. Tells you how much, you know, meat flank you're going to get on the legs, you know, how much is basically the, I don't know, there's a lot of measurements that's included with. So you can be really nerdy about it. But between these two, when they fall from the animal, the deer has the biggest distance. And so when it impacts the earth, there's going to be one edge of it that gets squished a little. So you'll have one flat side. So it's kind of like a teardrop shape. So that helps you identify if it was how tall the animal really was. Raccoon, armadillo, and opossum, like on this, they look very similar. They're not going to look similar on the thing. So for me, when I do actually find opossum scat, it's actually really wet. There's aquatic vegetation in it. For raccoons, it looks like a person, basically, because they eat everything. I've never actually found armadillo scat. If you do, send me a picture. I would love to have it. But armadillos are more insectivores. So you're going to have a lot of more body parts in that kind of scat, but also their body's taking up a lot of it. So I'm not really sure how, you know, what it truly looks like. I would love to see it. There's no, like, what's the word? For the state of Texas, I don't know who's studying armadillos. They're not getting their attention, you know? So if we can start that program, I would be more than excited. Skunks too. It's really hard to find skunk scat. It's probably going to be in the grasses and the bushes. They don't climb trees. So, you know, when they're out and about at night, it's to go to the restroom, but you might find some smaller little piles around. But coyote, bobcat, and fox are going to be the most common. And of course, coyote versus dog. So those who have dogs should be able to tell the difference. Our dogs are eating processed pellet food most of the time, unless your dog's on a raw diet. It's not going to have, you know, fur in it. It's not going to have animal appendages in it whatsoever. It'll probably be a uniform log color and shape. But for bobcats are true carnivores. So there shouldn't be any plant material in it whatsoever. And so you're going to have more tapered, pinched ends. And then for foxes, foxes are a species that like to claim their hidey holes. They don't want turtles and armadillos to sneak into those underground. So they will leave a pile right outside that hole, that burrow opening. So that helps you identify them too. And then a beaver. If you are lucky enough to find a beaver. It looks like wood chips, wood shavings, you know, the little bits of the bark and pieces that they were eating. And they can make these huge piles too, especially when it's like mating season. The boys make these nasty piles and they spray on it. They want the girls to smell that. So if you're out there fishing in the middle of nowhere and you smell something awful, you know, it's just a beaver flirting. He needs love too. All right, so here's a good coyote. So the Trinity River Skyline Trail, y'all, this is the Levee Trail. So if y'all have never been out on it, I think now, I don't know if y'all know, or you should know, I don't know. DFW, you know, wants to make this giant trailway amongst it all. And so I'm on the south side of that. So I've been from Trinity River Audubon Center all the way to Irving to the Katy Trail, which they're trying to link up White Rock Lake and the Santa Fe Trail with that. And then that'll eventually hit up to Plano. So one day, yes, we can backpack through DFW. Who knows who will want to. But you can, they're almost getting there. They're almost complete with a lot of these trails that are paved, and there's like police call boxes along the way and markers, so you know where you're at. But so it's a corridor for these animals to visit all of these places. So I have been to the levee trails very early in the morning, and I've seen herds of hogs. I've seen coyotes. I've seen deer. And so like downtown's right there on the other side of the levee. There's tons of animals living down there. The only issue is the mowing. I think they get, you know, the big mows, and they mow that whole levee corridor. So all those food and hidey holes, they do get destroyed. So it's a cycle the animals get used to, but you will see a lot of animals scat down there. But here's our coyote. All right. John Bunker Sands Wetland Center. Have y'all been there? Raise your hand if you've been there. It's awesome. If you have not been there, y'all, spend the money to travel down there. It's just, it's the south edge of Dallas County in Siegelville. It's a really great wetland center. They show a really good way how wetlands are purifying water. And I think that water gets shipped back up to Lake Levan or Rowlett, you know, some of the cities up there. It's a really cool system. They teach at the Nature Center. But they have boardwalks along it. Oh, there's also a bald eagle family there that they keep track of year round. And I think they just laid a new egg for this year. So they have that on camera. I'll just brag about them. Anyway, when you find the coyote scats though, these coyotes are swimming coyotes. They're fishing coyotes. You'll find a lot of mud in their scat. You're gonna find bird feathers. There's pink bird feathers, which makes me worry it's the spoonbills, you know? Cause there's a lot of birds that are gonna stay at this wetland center. So they almost make a latrine here because they're raising their puppies. It's a really good hunting ground for them. There's plenty of food available. So you'll see these just huge piles of scat there. All right. So this one's a really wet one. This was at Liz Dola. So this is our opossum. These are dedicated moms for sure. But you can just tell the vegetation's really wet. There's a mixture of like beetles. There's probably some seeds in there. So they were taking advantage of whatever food they could get, really opportunistic. And of all of the animals, opossums have the most varied diet. There's always, when you actually do like DNA analysis on these species, the opossums are going to have the most things. All right, what about these little pellets? What do y'all think? Deer, for sure. Yep. Cute little deer. What about this one? So somebody ate plants, right? But it didn't really get digested any. And so for me, this would signify that somebody new is in the environment. They're tasting things, seeing what they can eat, seeing what their body will allow. Just like us, when you try a new food, your body doesn't always digest it the first time, you know? And sometimes there's, you know, reasons they eliminate it so quickly is, you know, something scares them. This takes a minute. But he didn't get eaten either. But he probably left a pile somewhere a few seconds later. So when our bodies are stressed, when that cortisone level goes up, they want to eliminate whatever is going to waste time when you're trying to run away. So the act, even for humans, when you're stressed out, you need to go to the restroom. Like that's a fight or flight, you know, behavior. Your body's like, all right, are we about to start running? You know, birds do that too. When they're about to start flying away, they're going to relieve themselves to loose up some of that weight. All right. So here is a carnivore scat. It's just a lot of fur. It's been a few days for sure too, but it's really compact. They got a good meal that day. But this is our kitty cats, our bobcats. Just recognizing though, some people of course do let their house cats outside. And a lot of people love to claim they saw the biggest house cat ever, you know, but it's a bobcat, or they saw the black cougar, you know, I've heard that one a million times too. But just recognizing those differences in sizes though, between a house cat, unless you know someone who has the biggest Maine Coon cat, then maybe it was the Maine Coon cat. I'll let that person not argue with me about it. But it's most of the time, there's plenty of bobcats in the city. All right, here's another. You can just, you know, see the black organ tissue basically, and then all that fur coming through it. So just more carnivore examples, more kitty cat. All right, so this one, This is the Trinity Forest Trail right by Trinity River Audubon Center. It's this paved trail that keeps going south. So this was a huge, almost like a latrine. Like, this is a huge meal right here. And I don't think I have this in the PowerPoint, but in the mud, there's actually tracks. So they're cat tracks, but these cat tracks are at least 4 inches across. And so I sent this over to Sam Kieschneck. I was like, look what I found. You know, I got excited. So in my head, this was a mountain lion. And this was actually a month. This was in January of 2020. And then February of 2021, if y'all remember, there was a mountain lion in Rowlett that was shot and killed because a mountain lion somewhere else claimed to attack somebody, which wasn't true. Anyway, poor mountain lions. They don't get the recognition that they deserve, in my opinion. If we let our mountain lion population come back, they're going to help control those hogs for sure. But of course, here in the cities, no one wants to hear there's a mountain lion when their kids are out running around, of course. But they're a part of the ecosystem. They do help maintain that top-down effect for these smaller species and our hogs. But here's a huge pile of fur. There's feathers in here. This was a great hunter. And they actually put a tree branch over it. So all these little things are little dead flowers from that tree branch. So they were trying to cover it up. And so big cats in the wild, they'll try to cover up their kills or try to cover up their scents. So in my mind, I found mountain lion scat. I was sure of it. But of course, we don't want to always say on the news when there's a mountain lion, we don't want people to come out there and get them. But this was the middle of the city. Like, this is, track is the southern part of DFW. There's neighborhoods all around there, but it is that green corridor. Just looking at a map online, you could see, you know, from downtown Dallas, the Trinity River, where it travels. It is a huge green snake. There's plenty of woods around it. All right. So here's another skunk pile. You can see some of the fur. It's not the clearest of image, but a poor coyote made the wrong decision that day to eat a skunk. So I would not recommend it. Did y'all know that skunks as a pet is getting really popular? Because veterinarians can remove their glands. So it's just like a house cat. I mean, it's cute. In Texas, anyone can have anything as a pet with the right paperwork, but Tiger King, you know, we all watched that, right? We learned not to keep everything as a pet. All right, so here is a good beaver log. So really compact, looks like someone got into, you know, the Home Depot pile in the corner. And of course, whenever you're out there looking at beavers destroying the trees, pay attention to what trees they're destroying. Sometimes they're going after the ones we hate, like the Chinese tallow or something, but sometimes they're going after our cottonwoods and our black willows that maybe we want to keep for erosion around our wetlands. So I know there gets a lot of controversies of people who like the beavers, people who hate the beavers. I'm for the beavers because of what they do for the environment. There's a little beaver. All right, what about this one? This was at Trinity Skyline Trail. Who do y'all think did this? So this one's a little different. In the bottom right corner, there's like white residue also. So this is actually a bird. So when they're eating the berries, you know, sometimes they don't process all the way. But bird, you know, bird scat's gonna have the white. It's the mixture of the liquid and the solids together. We won't go into too many details, y'all. That I think is like styrofoam. It was just like trash from the river, sadly. All right, y'all should see these in y'all's front yards. These are castings. So these are earthworm. It's really interesting when you see like paved stones, paved walkways, you'll find in the tiniest of the cracks, some little casting piles. So the worms are coming up even through those. So it's at night when the temperature gets a little cold and the soil is a little softer, they can come to the surface, but they're aerating that. We want them to do that. They're making more gases, or they're moving the gases around. It's important. We need our worms for sure. Are y'all, anyone in here composters using their worms too? Awesome. Yeah. So when I go to the schools, I try to encourage them to start a composting thing with their kitchens. If they have a garden going at those schools, you know, try to get everything, get that permaculture concept really important for those kids. All right. So this was a cool project someone showed online. So for it was just like undergrads doing this, but it was called their River Otter Project. I think it was the State of Missouri school on aging scat. So when they found scat, they were keeping track of, you know, the temperature or just the weather that day and how long it took for that scat to actually decompose. Because when you do see it, you're not seeing the scat from 4 months ago, unless it's dog scat. So you're seeing that diet, you know, within the last, you know, 7 days. Pay attention to the weather to see how it does deteriorate, but then also how do the decomposers in that environment utilize that? Because this scat is very important for everything else that's living in that soil. And so I did my own little project. So this was coyote scat. When I found it in the sun, I said it was already 5 to 7 days old. And then when I came back a week later, it had already disintegrated into this. So it had rained. And then you see these little swirlies where the insects had gone in and got whatever nutrients they could. And it just made me think about like 8 of them swirling and eating and just being so happy in there, you know. And then with a stick, I could easily just like, it was just the fur that was left over. So it's really decomposed at that point. Eventually that fur will go into the wind. Maybe a bird will use it for its nest. You know, it's all connected. It's really sweet. It's gross, but. So this is a cool project. So if I could, y'all, I would work with bears. That would be my top species. But in Rocky Mountain National Park, one of their park rangers collects bear scat. And they have a greenhouse dedicated to this now. So you can actually use the seeds. And from one big pile, she's already done 1,200 seedling sproutings from the bear scat she's collected. And so those seeds are organic. Those are from that environment already. They've gone through that animal's body system. And that is way easier and cheaper than buying seeds from, you don't know where they're coming from. Or if you're picking the seeds yourself, you know, year after year, there might be different quality. So it's just a great way to repopulate your parks. And so I hope in Texas we can get there. We don't have as many bears yet, but there's other animals. We just gotta, you know, keep pushing this master scatters. I don't know. All right. If y'all didn't know this, butterflies love to eat scat. It's actually part of some of their mating rituals. The boys will deliver a nice pile of scat in their little hands for those girls. It's called mud puddling. It cracks me up whenever I see, no offense, I have tattoos too, but when I see like a girl with a butterfly right here, and in my head I'm like, that they're mud puddling, you know. They smell something, they want to deliver it to their mate, you know. So like, kudos for those people. They don't know how scientifically accurate their tattoo really is. But every time I see a butterfly tattoo, I do crack up about it. But so a lot of the camouflage even is to blend in with the ground because they're spending time on the scat. It's not always to blend in with flowers or tree bark. It could be to hide from, you know, they're down on the ground. There could be those skunks, those armadillos coming by, smaller little perching birds that want to get a good meal out of them. All right. And then we don't want to forget our detritivores. They're just as important here. And a lot of people will see scat and think it's a mushroom, or they see a mushroom and they think it's a scat. This was a good fairy ring that I found in Commerce, where A&M Commerce's location is at. When you do see a fairy ring, there's no fairies, I wish. Usually there is a septic tank leak right in the middle, or somebody's dog went to the restroom right in the middle. But what mycelium does, there's about 60 species that do this, is when the mycelium is, you know, getting their nutrients, they're going to spread in a 360 degree pattern. And once they're full of nutrients, they can sprout their reproductive organ, which is what the mushroom is. So you'll get that circle. It's not special. I'm actually not sitting in the very middle because I don't want to be where the actual food came from. But it was just kind of cool to find one that big. Oh, this is a really fun fungus. So I also love all the mushrooms and the lichens, but I get excited when I see bird nest funguses. You might see them in like your potted plants at home when you overfeed your potted plants.
But they literally look like little bird nests. They're really tiny. They're going to be growing, though, on herbivore scat. So different deer and squirrel sometimes, if it's true herbivore diet, and then rabbits. But what these things do is when it rains, the water is going to splash those spores into the air and help them spread. But it's really cute when you do see them. And then this one's really common on the trails, this jelly cyanobacteria. People think it's scat. It's there year round, actually. And in the summer, it really dries up and then you'll see it and it starts to get really moist again. But this is what's helping actually recycle that nitrogen in the system, in the soil. So we want this. I've seen people like rip it up, like throw it away as if it's bad. And it's supposed to be there. We want it to be there. We need it. And so just to help y'all remember, for decomposers. So fungi and bacteria, they decompose it externally. And so they're breaking down those enzymes into smaller things so that it can be used up by the plants. And so mycelium looks like this kind of white, really thin root system. You can find it under tree bark and under the soil. The mushroom is the reproductive organ. And then detritivores are the ones that actually consume, they eat and break down. And so, you know, our worms, pill bugs, vultures, those are detritivores. But so they're recycling it. So usually the detritivores come in first, and then fungi and bacteria can get down to, you know, the trees and the things like that. But this is my last slide, y'all, we're almost done. This is just to show the importance of scat. Scat is very important. So it took me forever to find this graphic where they actually included some little animal scats on the bunny. A lot of them exclude that part. But so nitrogen, you know, it is occurring in our on our planet, in the ozone and everything. But how it gets broken down is really important. So nitrogen-fixing bacteria is living on the legumes. So when y'all, you know, the plant nerds know what I'm talking about, and the C4 plants, those legumes are important. We need them, especially in Texas, for our soils. We get tons of fertilizer production on the farmlands that have tons of nitrogen in them. And then the decomposers are breaking down that nitrogen. So if we, sadly, what happens to a lot of habitats is you lose your animals. Those populations start going down, all right? But then that means whatever they're eating or not eating, that scat isn't happening. And plants will start to die because a lot of it could be seed distribution because those animals aren't there anymore. The pollinating species aren't there anymore. And so you're losing little bits of your ecosystem and not really realizing how it's going to affect then the soil. And so if you don't have those plants, there's no nitrogen fixing bacteria. So those parts of the cycle are gone. And then you're not going to have anything for decomposers to eat. And so once the decomposers are also gone, it's only fertilizer production. And so then you get an excess of nitrogen. And so when you get too much nitrogen, you're going to get ammonium in your air. Like China, for one, has a lot of ammonia going on in their ozone layers. DFW is not that great, y'all. We're kind of gross. If y'all check our ozone, it's not clean air here whatsoever. If you have too much ammonium, you know, that's going to limit growth. If you have too much nitrogen, that's when you get too much algae in your water systems. And algae can limit growth of other things. It can limit how much oxygen is in that water because it's taking it up too. So there are limitations. So we need the poop. The people who are studying like the savanna animals without those big elephants and giraffes, there's less scat there. And so then there's less plants getting populated, less fertilizer for the soil. And so those habitats are getting more and more dry, more erosion, the Sahara Desert will grow. So it's all connected for sure. Hopefully nothing in Texas is getting to that point, but even with our prairies, when we lose all of that and all those animals that were pooping in our prairies, we're losing all those nutrients. All right, and then just if y'all wanna be nerds on iNaturalist, you know, find the Scatology Project. And you can find animals from all over. There's, you know, gray fox, savanna elephant, bats. It's just kind of really cool to see how many people out there are actually tracking the scat on other continents even. And I love to check it. I want to see where this, you know, the elephants are, the rhinos are. Makes you feel a little good. At least one of them went to the restroom, right? He's happy. He's living his life. And then we got the dung beetles already at work here. So the system is working. It's happening. All right, but that's it. I wasn't sure if there was any questions on the Zoom or if y'all had any questions. There's a guy who's been studying the jaguar undies at the border of Texas for 14 years. He's only seen one in real life 3 times. So I'm sure he's studying the scat, you know, and everyone's saying the chupacabra's this and that. But, oh yeah, so someone's mentioned the feral hog. So that feral hog scat, that was in the summer. That was July, heat of the heat, you know, worst of it all. So it depends on the season too. So when I left it in my car, actually. I have this little box that has coyote scat, but it's 6 different types. So it's from the same location, but 6 different diet criteria, you know, what's in there, whether did they catch a bunny? Did they catch a squirrel? Was it a bird? Are they eating honey locust and grasshopper? So just like us, our, you know, their diet will vary to what's available that day that they were eating. Their scat's not going to be the food from last Tuesday and then the following Friday. You know, even for us, our systems don't jam it up together like that. So you're seeing what they ate for that one meal. So the person online, you know, just compare what species are on your property to see what you can identify in the scat. When lizards do not urinate, it appears as a white crystal attached to the scat. Yeah, similar to birds. Yeah, reptiles have very unique scat. I also rescue box turtles. So I have 8 of them at home. And they love to scat in their water dish. And you hear it. You hear this like gurgly noise in the morning because like they have to wait until their heat lamp warms them up, you know, to go for it to travel through their system. And then they'll keep swimming in it. They don't care. But it actually makes really good water for my indoor plants. So I have a nice little system going. Oh, yeah. So there are, I think it was on my last slide. There are some species that eat scat. It was the name for it. I have somebody's thesis from like 1891. It's this huge book. It came from Oxford University, but it was the worldwide scatology notes from this one explorer. So he went to all these cultures around the world to learn who's using scat and urine in their ceremonies, in their medicine, you know, and this was, you know, the 1800s, of course. We're not doing that still, hopefully. But there are some communities and animals, I think that was on my last slide, that that do eat scat. I mean, yeah, so I don't know how many of y'all have dogs. My friend has a Boston Terrier that eats everybody's scat it can find. So even our dogs will do it. Children will do it if you're not watching them. But like, you know, cows will eat it. Rabbits, of course, eat their own to redigest those nutrients. It's a lot of herbivores that do eat scat. If it's, you know, desperate times, I'm sure raccoons and hogs will get what nutrients they can out of something. Because your body doesn't always process everything. Even with like elephants, it's only about 60% of that food that gets digested. So companies make what's called poo paper out of the fibers that aren't digested. And it's a pretty good green way to use some paper. Oh, is that a rhyme? It says it starts with an S and it ends with a T. It comes out of you. It comes out of me. I know what you're thinking, but don't call it that. Let's be scientific and call it scat. That's funny. Awesome. All right, any more questions?
Chemical scat analysis, not to determine health.
Oh, chemical wise, I'm not sure. You would have to Google that. I know that if y'all want, you can donate your scat. You can do those gut transplants for people who don't have the bacteria living in their systems, a lot of like cancer patients and such. Y'all can always do that if you are pretty regular and you got your probiotics going, you know, would be a great way to donate for people who need it. But it's important, you know, if your body doesn't have that gut bacteria, it's not breaking things down properly. But chemical wise, I don't know the exact specifics, but one day I'll be a scat donator. I mean, it depends on how much knowledge you know about where all the water came from, like the stormwater treatment plants, you know, it all gets kind of muddled together. There's no way of knowing which exact neighborhood it came from unless they're paying attention by the tunnels in the system. But I will say dog scat is the worst thing in our system, especially Houston and Dallas in general. People are not picking up their dog poo. It does not get digested by the detritivores because it's processed. And so that's the biggest thing at those wastewater treatment plants is getting that out of the system, because people leave it on the soil. They're like, oh, the water will take it away. If it actually gets to the Trinity River, the Trinity flows down to Houston in about 3 weeks and then into the ocean. So it's going to affect all those other ecosystems. So we got to pick up our dog poop for sure. I mean, it would be white. It would be the nasty white bird kind, but I'm sure it's a little bit more acidic just for their breaking things down. But I haven't studied vultures in specific. I bet the zoo people would know. All right, and tools, yeah, you can just use guides. There's books. There's little, this wrist lit little thing from Northwood Guides Incorporated. It's just called Animal Scat. So it's for all America. They don't separate it by, you know, Eastern or Western. There's one for Texas and, you know, specific. Sorry. But a lot of this scat, if you're going up in the mountain regions, like if you go to Colorado, you probably want a guide from up there. If you want the West Coast with all the different herds of animals up there, we don't have, you know, I can't recommend a specific brand. They're all pretty good. I like to actually get the hunter ID, the predator ID books, because they go into more detail about other things you would find when they scat, like not just the scat, but where do they scat, where do they hide it, things like that. And so you go to like Cabela's, their book section is really good for things like that. Bass Pro Shops. All right, is that it, y'all? Any more?
That was a great presentation.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. So we're appreciative of her time and the effort and her knowledge and her ability to have a good time with a funny topic. It made it a whole lot of fun. Thank you very much. Just a couple little things. I think it's about a half hour for the business part and an hour and a quarter for the AT part. A couple of little things to mention before we break. Jeff LaQuay is here today. And we're so glad you're back. Jeff was in a bicycle accident. He attracted wildlife, but not the wildlife you want. These were dogs, and you've had a rough recovery, but we're really glad you're back. Thank you. Also, Harriet, will you stand up a second? She is our member at large. And so if any of you have suggestions on how we could be better, or things that you'd like to see, or suggestions about anything at all about our organization and our chapter, please let her know. There is also a link on our website that you can fill out and it'll get right to her. Well, it was a great meeting. Thanks to everybody for coming. Thanks to all you folks at home. We miss you. We want to see you next month.